Tourists.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for all you being here. It's my pleasure to be here. The topic of my research is basically how government announcements about future government spending affects the consumer confidence and the real economy. So let me start my presentation with this figure, just to be visualize what I'm going to talk about. What we see here is the quarterly GDP growth in blue line and quarterly Michigan University Consumer Confidence Expectations Index in red dashed line in the US over the last 50 years. So here the Consumer Confidence Index is constructed on a survey that measures the individual's expectations about their individual income and aggregate business conditions over the next year, and a great economy as a whole in the next 5 years. So, there are many different definitions of confidence. Throughout my presentations, I'm going to stick to this definition, this empirical index, especially the first two components, will be the base for my confidence index. Expectations of the individual about their personal income and aggregate business conditions over the next 12 months or over the next year. We see that these two series are somewhat correlated, but more importantly, consumer confidence index is closely watched by market parts, like financial sector, corporate managers, or even the government. Why? Because this index is generally accepted as a leading indicator. So when confidence index is high, agents or households are more optimistic about the future of the economy. And when they are more optimistic, they spend more. And when they spend more, the GDP increases, because consumption is the largest component of GDP. I prefer to avoid going deep discussion whether this is truly a leading indicator or not. But a simple Granger-Cozzardi test shows that confidence Granger causes GDP growth. So confidence index is useful variable in forecasting GDP growth. This result is also in line with the recent research by Barsky and Sims, in which authors find innovations to confidence predict future increase in GDP. And one last thing about this figure is that we see the largest and the longest drop in both series happened during the Great Recession. This gray block in the over the right hand side. And there was a debate exactly at that period. So what was this debate? Some economists argue that US economy stagnated during the Great Recession because people were pessimistic about the future of the economy. So when they are pessimistic, they cut their spending and GDP remains stagnant. Exact same time, some economists even add to this argument and they said, we can use fiscal policy, especially fiscal stimulus. So the idea was that a stimulus is going to help in recovering from the recession because it's going to have positive impact on public confidence. So the argument is that government announces stimulus with massive increase in government spending in the future. People become more confident about the economy. They start spending, and GDP will start recovering also, and the recession will end. So that was the main argument. But this was met with some skepticism. As Cochrane put, there was no theoretical or empirical evidence to support or contradict this, let's say, confidence channel of fiscal. And exactly this last statement is the main motivation of my paper. What is the impact of US fiscal spending policy on consumer confidence? And what is the role of this confidence channel in the transmission of fiscal policy on the real economy? So these are the main questions I'm trying to answer in my research. But there is one important feature in fiscal stimulus. It gives information about future government spending. So let's look at this table. This table shows the highway spending bits in the American Reinvestment and Recovery Act in 2009. When the IRA was enacted in January 2009,
Government was authorized to spend 27.5 billion on highway spans. But this money was not spent immediately. Rather, it was dispersed over years. But when the IRA was enacted, when the bill was legislated, agents in the economy know that the total authorized amount, or in other words, fiscal use. So basically, this total amount, 27.5 billion, was in the information set, and maybe this news are important in the formation of the expectation process of the agents and their consumption saving behavior related to the actual spendings. And these fiscal news are not only happen during fiscal stimulus, like during key events like Gulf War 1 and 2, 9/11, or fall of Berlin Wall. There was some information today that is predictive or informative about future governments. So why is this important? If as an econometrician, when I'm doing my analysis, if I only use the actual government spending data, I would be missing this fiscal news. Because if you look at this total budget authority, information is not incorporated in the actual spendings. So as an econometrician, my information, if I use the actual spending data, my information set would be smaller than the information set of the agents. And if this is the case, my analysis would not have a correct estimation. So what should I do? I should find a way to enlarge my information set and align with the information set of the agents. So how do I do that? I construct this news where in the US at every quarter, forecasts about key macroeconomic variables are published by survey professional forecasters. So basically I went to their website, SPP's website, I took the government spending forecasts, and then I measured the differences between current quarter forecast and the previous quarter forecast. So basically this difference or revision to the forecast should give me the information that becomes available in the current period that is informative about future goals. So the aim of this variable is to capture the expectations of the agents today about government spending in the future. That's the first step in Africa. Then I use this variable with confidence index and some macro variables, and I identify shocks to my fiscal news variable. So these are the shocks that are unrelated to current economic conditions, but informative about future government spending. And then I measure the responses of confidence, consumption, and output to my identified shock. And in the last step of my analysis, I answer the question, what would happen to the economy if fiscal news shock does not have impact on consumer confidence? So basically, I isolate the role of confidence in the transmission of fiscal policy on the real economy. This is the empirical part. And in detail, then I built a model to go more deeper into this confidence channel of fiscal policy. I extended Lorenzoni's imperfect information model by introducing government sector. And I try to understand what is the mechanism inside the fiscal policy that shifts the confidence or expectations of the agents. So why today's announcements about future government spending affects the consumption saving behavior of the households through expectation channels or confidence. Also, when we have a model, we can estimate it, right? It's a structural model, and then we can make counterfactual analysis. And with this counterfactual analysis, we can quantify the role of confidence in the economy. That's the, also another aim of building a model. So my main finding here is that in the US, when government announces higher spending in the future, it boosts consumer confidence. So people are more, become more optimistic about the future of the economy. They increase their spending, they spend more, and that's why 1 year fiscal multiplier is larger than one. It's 1.8, exactly because of this crowding effect of government spending on private consumption. When I kill the response of confidence in my VAR, in that case, the positive response of consumption disappears. So, when confidence channel is shut down, what I'm saying is people are neither optimistic nor pessimistic about the future of the economy, so they are neutral. And in that case, they do not spend as much as they spend when they are optimistic, and that's why 1 year fiscal multiplier is less than one, 0.82. So basically, this almost $1 difference in the fiscal multiplier is due to the change variation in the confidence of the households. Now, on the theory side, what I find is that I have an imperfect information model. So basically, agents do not observe the true state of the economy. And in such economy, if agent expects higher government demand, so if they expect more to sell to the government rather than to pay taxes, they will expect higher disposable income or higher permanent income. And in that sense, their confidence increases. And when this is the case, when their confidence increases, they spend more. And this is why consumption increases. So basically here, I'm proposing a new channel of fiscal policy, basically shift in confidence that can explain the positive response of confidence in response to government spending.
I have two questions here. So when the government announces this spending, we look here at the effect on consumption. Would you expect there to be an effect on firms' decisions?
Yes.
And then is this 180 accounting for that, or?
So 180 is the total response.
Okay.
Total response of GDP.
Yeah.
Part of could be increasing investment also.
Okay.
But here I just looking at consumption.
Okay.
Because when I have too much variables in VAR, then I will have problems in estimation.
Okay. And this 180 is within the first year, second year there's...
It's decreasing.
It's going down.
Yeah, and in 4 or 5 years it becomes zero. So basically this is only stimulates the economy in the like short to medium run.
Okay.
In the long run, the impact goes negative.
And this is probably, you're going to talk about this, but just to put the findings in perspective, if you have a household that's constrained assets or it's over-leveraged, does this play a role? Because there are these models that talk about why we observe this relatively muted effect of lower credit. Right? So now comes to mind the alternative channels.
Could be.
Right, and then you could be, they say borrowing is cheaper, why don't you buy a bigger house or change the car or the refrigerator, etc., etc. So both short-term and long-term. And once you are an LTV of 110 or 20 where the house is underwater, then no, this doesn't matter. It's, the effect is not there. So the question is in the VAR, whether this plays a role or not.
So in the VAR, I don't separate if easing credit conditions or more demand credit has impact on consumption. Because as I said, like I'm just looking at the general, like the overall responses here. But even if that's the case, like why would households should demand for higher credit?
No,
why should banks have better conditions in giving credit? This can be also related to changes in confidence.
Yeah, absolutely. My point is that this depends on whether the constraint is binding or not, or what you already have to spend on your existing credit.
Maybe we can look at, maybe we can separate the consumption in durables and non-durables.
Yeah.
Like for example, if it's increasing in durables, then maybe we can look at,
yeah.
But here I didn't, this can be something interesting extension to my research. So basically my research touches several strands in the literature.
Of course, I'm not the first paper that's there is Darwin's spanning and confidence. The first one is Bachmann and Sims, where authors looked at surprise Darwin's spanning shows without controlling for fiscal news, and they find a positive response of confidence to a surprise Darwin's spanning shock. When I control for the fiscal news, these surprise shocks, like unexpected Darwin's spanning shocks, do not have any more impact on confidence, and mostly all the response of confidence goes through the fiscal news shocks. There is another paper by Azina Kohler and Javazi where authors use narratively identified exogenous fiscal consolidation plans over a panel of OECD countries. And what they find is announcements of cut in government expenditure boosts business confidence. So what I find is actually announcements of higher spending boosts confidence. So in that case, rather than complementarity, my result and Alizina Horan-Javans is like contradictory. I think the main reason here is that I'm just looking at US data. There the authors look at the average of OECD countries. So maybe US has some certain country-specific characteristics that plays a huge role in my results. Maybe because of the situation of dollar, or because of the government debt, or maybe because of some other behavioral factors. Like fiscal news, there's a growing literature in using fiscal news in the empirical fiscal policy. It starts with Ramey. Then Overbo and Gorodnichok, California and Gambetti, they also use the survey data to control for the fiscal news. And both authors, they find increasing consumption in response to fiscal news. But they were silent about explaining why this is the case. Why this is important? Because in standard RBC models, when government increases spending, people cut consumption. Because when government spending increases, people expect higher taxes in the future. So they expect decrease in their permanent income. And that's why they cut their consumption expenditures. But here, the empirical facts say something opposite. Empirical analysis says consumption actually increases following the government spending shock. So here I'm arguing the variation, the increase in consumer confidence is the main reason of the crowding effect of government spending on private consumption. So as I said, like in standard RBC models, we cannot match empirical fact, empirical increase of private consumption to the government spending shock. So there was authors proposed different mechanisms to be able to match the model with the empirical facts. Like Ron, Schmidt, Grohe, and Urbe, they argue complementarity of private consumption and government spending in utility function. So if there's complementarity, when government spending increases, you also increase your private consumption because of the complementarity of utility function. Or Gary, Lopez, Solida, and Wireless, they inserted budget constraint households, rule of thumb, so relativity constraint. And what they find is, when if government spending increases wages, this liquidity constraint consumers spend all their income. So when their wage increases, their consumption also increases. And if share of this constraint budget households is large enough, the overall response of consumption increases as well. And finally, some authors argued the zero lower bound. When there is the zero lower bound, there is a high negative real interest rate following your spending shock. So basically, instead of saving, you want to increase your cost. What I'm adding to this theory work is that the change in your expectations can increase your consumption. Basically, the boost in confidence is the main reason of higher government spending on private consumption. And in the last case, there is a literature on news shocks and imperfect information. So the idea here is that people do not observe the shocks, like for example, technology shocks.
And technology-shaped shocks have two components. One is fundamental, and another one is noise. That is orthogonal to the economic variables. So when there's a noise shock, this can create temporary increase in confidence and output. What I'm showing here is that policy shock can also generate a temporary fluctuation in confidence and output. Basically, this was an overview of my research, so maybe now I can go more deeper in what I'm doing, starting with empirical part, with physical use. So as I said, in the US, at every quarter, survey professional forecaster collects forecasts of macroeconomic variables from survey respondents and then publishes them on their website. Now, let's assume GT denotes governance value. Then the second term is government spending H period ahead forecasted at time T by the individual respondent I. So basically, this is the today's expectations about future governance. Okay. By individual respondent. Then I average of these individual respondents and I have the SPP mean for government spending forecast. Then what I do is I take the revisions, cumulative revisions. So basically I sum the differences between current quarter forecast and previous quarter forecast over the next 3 periods. So there are 2 things here. One is I'm using forecast revisions. As you see, these are the differences between today's and yesterday's forecast. So basically, this should tell me the information that becomes available today at time t that is informative about future governance. So basically, in that sense, I'm controlling for the information at time t about future governance plan or fiscal use.
And period is a quarter, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
And why 3 quarters? Why not 4?
Because forecasts are up to the next 4 quarters.
Okay, and you can do only for 3 quarters.
Yes, because I'm losing 1 quarter because of the lagged forecast. Exactly. And why I'm doing cumulative is that cumulative forecasts have better predictive power of future government spending related to the single period forecasts. That's why here I'm using the cumulative government spending for this.
So the fiscal news are the average summed up deviations over the quarters, right? Because you work with the ET, not EIT.
Yes, average, exactly.
And the reason I'm asking this is because you know there's this humongous literature on the second moment and what they tell us. This kind of
the next
5 years of research.
Yes. Exactly, because if there is variance between the
within the group of forecasts.
Exactly.
Because that by itself is also extremely useful information. The disagreement in the I'm not sure that for this particular group of forecasters, but in general for consumption and etc. investments. The disagreement among expectations within the group of regions.
I look at this variance for government spending forecast. What I see is during this, when there is a shock, positive shock in news, this disagreement is decreasing.
Uh-huh.
So people are, so there's some signal that is informative, more informative to everyone. Doesn't people observe better during the shock periods. But I can put that here. I'm just working with the averages.
Okay. And the other thing that it's also interesting here, because this is going to be our primary, driving force instead of the empirical exercise. Right?
Exactly.
So
exactly.
If we define this differently, then potentially the outcome might look differently.
Yes.
Government can spend more because they tax the same, but then they borrow. Or lower taxation. And these two mechanisms imply very different macro outcomes.
Yes.
For the same amount of revision. Do they know, like,
here? You mean
the forecasters themselves? Because you see, what we do, we believe they have a causal mechanism in their head, which we then embed in the macro model.
Yes.
But if you're a forecaster, I'm a forecaster, you see that the government spends more, I read the news on taxation, you read the news on debt, you think the government spends more because they borrow more, I think the government spends more because taxes are different. And then what we have in our head is fundamentally a different economic model.
Exactly.
Even though there it shows up like
this. Here, the problem is we don't have forecast data on future taxes or public debt. So we are just limited to government spending. But what I will show you is that generally, like these high government spendings in the future are financed through debts.
No.
I will show you. This might be also another. So now. Now I have this variable. So now I want to show you how I'm going to identify the exogenous component in this variable. So I can study the causal impact in my data analysis, right?
This G is the percentage to GDP, or this is?
This is the government spend growth.
Growth, okay.
Because there are changes in like levels, so I'm using growth. Yeah. But before going on that, I want to show you one thing, the nature of the forecasts. Here I will tell you a framework, which I take from Koibol and Gorodichenko, and I inserted news shock, news process into this framework. So I describe this framework, then I will test the implications of this framework using data. Now, assume that I have AR1 government spending process, GT. UT is the surprise shock, and epsilon T minus 1 is the news shock. You see, this is with epsilon T minus 1 is with a lag. So when there is shock in epsilon T, it's going to affect government spending one period ahead. So this is why we call it news shock. Here I make assumption that these survey respondents or agents, they cannot observe perfectly GT and epsilon T, but rather they receive signals as a function of these variables. Like signal one gives me information about government spending with some idiosyncratic noise, and signal two gives me information about fiscal news shock with again some idiosyncratic noise. These signals are at individual level, also the noises. But the mean of the noises are zero, and with constant rates. So what agents do here? They use these signals to form expectations about future government spending. Okay. So when I average these expectations of the agents and rearrange, I end up with the relationship. GT minus expected GT, which is my forecast errors, are function of readings. Forecast revisions, here I can show you. This is my forecast errors here. These are forecast revisions. These are news shocks, and these are surprise shocks. K is my Kalman gain. How much weight I placed on my signal relative to my previous period forecast. Okay. If I had perfect information, that K would be equal to 1. So I put all weight onto the new information. Then this coefficient here would be 0. But if there is imperfect information, the forecast errors are predicted by forecast revisions. So this is what I'm going to test. So here, I have government spending forecast errors, and here I have forecast revisions. So the null hypothesis is beta equal to 0, says me, there are no information predictions. Okay? If I can reject the null, then it means there is information predictions, right? And when I run this test,
But I find this beta is almost equal to zero and significant at 10% level. So basically, forecast errors are predicted by forecast ranges. And beta equal to 1 means k is equal to 0.5. So a just put half to the new information and half to the near previous one. And then I control with some additional like government spending on federal tax rate. It doesn't change. When I add debt to GDP ratio, it's still close to 1, but it's not significant anymore. So I will look at that part more. So why I'm showing you this, right? So what is the value added of this information to you? Remember, I told you this system. Government spending and two signals. Okay. Again, when I use the average of expectations and rearranging, I end up with this relation. Here, this is my news variable I just showed you 2 slides ago. Really, cumulative revision forecast. Now, here I have 2 components. One is the lag news variable. This is because of the information predictions. Because in the previous period, I didn't observe fully all the information, and part of that information I observe in the current period. That's why that variable is there. And here is my fiscal news shock, epsilon t. So you see how I'm using my news variable to identify the shocks. If I directly regress, for example, GT using actual data, right? Actual work spending data. My residual will be a combination of these two terms. So I wouldn't identify new shock and suppression. It will be a combination of two. But when I include news, when I use news variable, I can identify my new shock, which is epsilon p. That's why I need all these explanations, construction, surveyor professional forecast, everything. Just to get epsilon t. So then I, and now, of course, there might be other variables that can affect my use variable. So here I estimate VAR. This is my release form equations. And here are my variables. So consumer confidence expectations index, I described in the beginning of the presentation. I have fiscal variables, real variables, and federal funds rate, and my news variable. So basically, in this setup, I'm controlling for lag news variable because of the adjustment of information. And then I apply Cholesky ordering to identify the shocks. So basically, the assumption is that news variable do not have contemporaneous impact on market values. That's the identification assumption. This is how my fiscal news shocks look like. These are the residuals from VAR, from my previous VAR estimation, through Cholesky ordering, right? So we see like this high, like when there is a tax reform, right? People expect the lower government spending in the future. You following 9/11, or Obama stimulus of GAFA, there is a positive spike. So actually, people expect higher government spending in the future. That's what these shocks tell me. So generally, we see like during key events, there are spikes, positive or negative. So let's say I hope you like this. Like at least they are informative about future government spending. But there are 2 important things here. These fiscal news shocks should satisfy. One thing is that the VAR I used should be informationally sufficient. So the variables I used in my VAR spans the information set of the agents. In that case, I can tell that my shocks are unpredictable, orthogonal to the past state variables. Okay? So So I can recover the true shocks in that case. So this is what I'm going to test. This is what I tested here. I conducted two orthogonality tests to ensure that my physical new shocks are orthogonal to the past state variables. So my bearing is information is sufficient, and my shocks are true structural shocks. Okay. These orthogonal tests are nothing but graduate causality tests. So in the first test, I run a b-variable AR with two variables, my physical news shocks and Raymond literary news variable. This Raymond literary news variable is constructed on reading journals and periodicals about which meters span. And mine are identified shocks. So here what I find that Raymond literary news does not graduate cross physical news shocks. So basically they don't predict my shocks, okay? In the second test, I conduct fundamentalist test proposed by Forney and Gambetti. The idea here is that we extract principal components from large set of macroeconomic variables, like more than 100 macroeconomic variables. And we assume this principal component spans the information set of the agents. Then we apply graduate causality test to see whether these principal components can predict my physical condition. So here I did this graduate causal test for first 1 to 6 principal components up to 4 legs, so total 24 tests, and none of them graduate causes my physical condition. So I can tell that here also this test shows my shocks are unpredictable.
So this is good in the sense of the exercise, but my question is, we kind of know when the physical news come, they come after a bad macro shock.
But here shouldn't be, right? Because I control for all the variables here.
Yeah.
Here I'm controlling for all, like if there's a bad macro shock, GDP should decrease, right? I'm controlling for that here.
And the macro, or you work with real GDP as growth rates?
No, levels. Okay. But it's. But here I'm controlling for the mean,
yeah,
so it will give me the variations.
How about long-term rates here? 10 years bond yields or something like that. I just see federal funds rate.
Yes. You mean government 10-year bonds?
Yeah.
I did it, but I didn't put here. They don't change a lot. The results won't change a lot.
That's where I would expect to find the first signal of fiscal news, is when we have some changes in the yield curve.
Could be, yes. But I tried, but I didn't find any big changes in that case.
Maybe I have a follow-up question. But instead of real GDP, would it make sense to work with a gap? Some form of gap? Because, you know, a lot of stuff that we do, fiscal agencies look at the gaps when they think about things in general.
Mm-hmm.
And if they have the feeling there's more room, the news might be larger. And that room might be the GDP gap. That's why I'm saying it's good for the exercise, but I would also expect that they are following some unobserved component in the economy as well.
Yes, I control for that in the robustness check,
okay.
But I control for the total factor productivity.
Okay.
That can be some, if this is correlated with GDP gap, then it should be informative. But I agree, I can do that, the same exercise with GDP gap and see.
Because if it survives, then we know for sure that the news are news even for the fiscal agency.
Yes,
that's right.
Ah, that's okay.
Because the information set and the agents, we talk about agents in the economy, but there's also, let's call it the fiscal agent.
I see.
And the fiscal agent's function is
also advanced this
to some degree, I would say, yeah.
Yes.
Because they know many more aspects of spending, taxation. So they say, okay, next period I know what the gap might be. Given some.
But if agents cannot observe this at all, then it shouldn't change their behavior, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. For the moment it's fine.
Yes,
right, for the model itself.
Yes, because I'm just looking at.
But you would be peeling the onion one layer.
Okay.
Right? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we can talk. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the last slide about fiscal neutral, so I don't want to bore you anymore. I think this is overlooked in the literature, what I'm doing now here. Yes, this is orthogonal to class variables, I control for many things, but at the end, what I want to here to capture is that these shocks should only capture the variations in government spending. Not the changes, it shouldn't predict changes in monetary policy or changes in tax policy or some other types of news. It should be just related to fiscal side of the economy. I made a simple test here. I have here my identified fiscal news shocks, and this ZIT is the shocks identified in the literature, like tax, consumer sentiment, monetary policy, uncertainty, and technologies. So here again, my null says if beta is equal to zero, then my shocks, fiscal news shocks, are not correlated with other shocks, right? And we see this is precisely the case for all shocks except the literary news of rate. And this is something I should expect. Because both me, my shocks, and the literary news of rate tries to capture the variations in future governments. So, this test, as far as for me, tells me that my shocks only capture changes in government spending, not changes in other policy. So here is my impulse response. There is a fiscal news shock at time t0, okay, which is not very persistent. Then government spending increases gradually, but persists over time. And what we see here is that federal tax rate does decreases, but not significantly. So basically, what this tells from this picture, I think I can tell, is that this increases, so this expansionary government spending episodes are financed by public debts, not with higher taxes. If we consider the spike in debt to GDP ratio in US over the last 30 years, I think these results are in line with that empirical factor. So the tax rates do not change, but government spending increases, so it should be financed with debt. No? The response of monetary policy is, I think, interesting because it increases, but this response is not very persistent. So there is a spike and then it again goes back to zero. So I don't know if maybe you guys can tell me here whether we can think of this as accommodative or active monetary policy.
I was not with Bernanke in the room when they did this. But it almost looks like monetary policy is undoing the
almost,
right? The fiscal.
Yeah, but even in that case, still the consumption increases. So here is the new evidence. Confidence increases here. There's a spike. But actually, this is not very long with, yes? It's just positive for the first year, and then it decreases. So basically, announcements of the government increases confidence, but this increases just for 1 year, and then it decreases. GDP increases, and here consumption increases, which is puzzling from RBC perspective. And as we see, these are positive, these responses are positive of both GDP and consumption for the like up to 3 years, and over in the long term it goes negative. Then I guess some robustness checks whether my results are still valid under different modeling. So first, this is standard, like I order fiscal news first. Then I include GDP news. agents may not only observe fiscal news, right? May not only observe news related to fiscal policy. They may also observe news to other variables in their company. So, for other news, I'm controlling those news by including GDP news in my analysis. I regress my fiscal news variable on GDP unemployment and inflation news to remove the forward-looking component of my news variable. Here I include TFP, utilization adjusted total factor productivity. The idea here is that maybe the shock, like government makes announcement exactly when the economy starts recovering. And if this is something unobservable, the recovery of economy, then we might not correctly apply this recovery of economy to the fiscal news shocks, right? Here I'm controlling for this using including TFP. I run the same exercise by excluding the Great Recession because there was zero lower bound in my baseline estimation. So they might even they might drive this positive response of consumption. So here I'm controlling for that. And finally, I include that to GDP ratio to control for the feedbacks. These are all the impulse responses I have. Blue line is my baseline, and all the like there are six more lines, and they are all related to those robustness checks. So what we see here is more or less the responses are similar. I think the main difference here is that when I exclude Great Recession period, we see response of consumption, confidence is low relative to the baseline. Also, response of consumption is low relative to the baseline. So basically, the Great Recession period or this zero lower bound period has some amplification effect, but it does not change the nature of the results. Even I exclude this zero lower bound period, still the response of consumption is positive. So still the main effect is there. Now is the last part of the empirical analysis. So what I did here is that how economy behaves if fiscal news shock does not have impact on confidence. Okay. Here I follow, to answer this question, I follow Sims and Zarr, Bachmann and Sims. So what I'm doing here is I have my estimated VAR, I keep it, and then I add exogenous confidence shocks. Okay. In a way, to keep the response of confidence at zero to a fiscal news shock at all horizons. Of course, this method has some drawbacks. It's not the perfect setup because I don't take into account changing expectations of the agents following confidence shock. So it's not immune to Lucas critique. But still, it gives me information about the counterfactual results. So when confidence is fixed at zero, we see that the response of consumption and GDP becomes much smaller. You see, this is my baseline, blue line, and these are when the confidence channel is shut down, the red dashed green lines. So basically, now, summarizing all my empirical analysis with this figure tells me that confidence is important in transmission of fiscal policy. Okay. But one question remains unanswered in this analysis: why confidence increases? So why do you expect improvement in your personal income or business conditions in the next year when government announces higher government spending in the future? Why? What changes your expectations? Now I'm going to answer this question through a model. It's a standard model. The only difference is that I have islands. Okay. So this is an imperfect information model. Come on. Left. Oops. Okay, so we are all islands, okay, separately. And there is one representative agent in each island. So as an agent in island L, I can visit all of you and buy goods from all of you, okay, from you. And at the same time, you can visit me and purchase goods from me, produce in mine, okay. So I go fast now. So this is the standard maximization problem of the household. Log utility and disutility from labor. This is the composite consumption that I purchase goods from, purchase from other islands. And this is my budget constraint. I can invest in bonds or consume, and I can finance these purchases with my financial savings, labor income, profits from the firms, transfers from the government. Okay? So these are the again standard first order conditions, like my consumption demand for the good produced in another island is the ratio of prices and normalized by my aggregate consumption is an agent in island. Okay, then I have like everything is standard here. Like this is the price of the bond. This is my change in future consumption and prices. Budget, this is my aggregate budget, government budget constraint. So what I purchase is financed by lump sum taxes. So there are no distortionary taxes or there is no public debt in the sector, okay? And I can also express this aggregate budget constraint as in terms of goods and items, okay? Since government does not have objective function here, I assume the demand of government is determined by ratio of the prices, aggregate government spending, and some price insensitive fraction of the demand. And here is the firm side. So firms produce for government and for private consumption. To meet the demand, they use labor. And there is a color pricing here. Only 1 minus theta of firms are allowed to optimize their prices. And this is the problem of the firm in island L that produces goods L. Okay. So what I do here is that I'm solving this model by log linearizing the model equations and looking at log linear deviations to a symmetric steady state, non-stochastic steady state. Okay. This is my government spending process. It's an AR again, and this is my fiscal news where I go, which is again AR with fiscal news show. So basically, I'm going to study how my economy, how the model variables behave when I give a shock to epsilon t. This is the whole idea in this. Okay. So this is the main difference here. This is the local consumer price index in island L. Okay. When I log linearize it, I assume this local price index is function of 2 things, aggregate price and idiosyncratic shock at island level. So the idea here is that I observe this local price index, but I don't know if the change in my price index is because of aggregate price, changes in the aggregate price, or idiosyncratic price. So basically, I'm forcing agents not to observe the aggregate price. Okay? And this is the signal for them. So I'm giving this. So they only observe this signal. But they don't know whether the change in the signal is because of change in prices or because of some idiosyncratic noise.
Listen. This is only for CPI or for all variables?
So this is for CPI. Okay. This is for local private demand.
Okay.
This is for local government demand and local tax.
Okay.
So basically, agents only observe this, but they don't know whether this change is because of the fiscal news shock or because of some idiosyncratic process. So they are confused. Okay. And this is my Taylor rule, like interest rate is AR process, and there's a response to changing inflation. Again, this is also a noise measure with true inflation and some aggregation. So agents do not observe any state variables here. They just observe signals that are function of these state variables. So these are my equilibrium conditions, right? Euler equation in item L. The current consumption for the agent in item L is expected future consumption less real interest, expected real interest. So this is my budget constraint. This part here is y minus tau is my disposable income. Okay. So I construct my confidence index as a counterpart of empirical index with two components. Average of individual expectations of future disposable income plus average of individual expectations of aggregate output. This is my confidence index. So I skip this part here. I calibrate some parameters. Then I estimate the remaining parameters by minimizing the distances between my their impulse responses and the impulse responses from my model. So what I can show you here is that in the estimation, I have very low persistence of monetary policy rule and very low standard deviation of noise in government demand signal, but the same parameter is very high in tax signal. So let me show you then the model and DAR responses. So the blue line is my empirical impulse responses from my DAR, and the red dashed line is my model's responses with calibrated and estimated parameters. So we see here the government spending and the federal funds rate more or less very similar. Here, confidence increases. So following government spending shock, agents expect increase in their future disposable income and aggregate output. Okay? Of course, I cannot capture this second round change in confidence because I have only one shock, so I have smooth curves in the model. GDP increases, and here is the new part, consumption increases. Not as much as in the empirical case, but still I can capture, especially in the first year, for the first 3 to 4 quarters, I can capture the increase in consumption. Now I will show you why this happens. Okay, remember, this is my government demand signal. I have some idiosyncratic noise. This is the variance of this noise here, which I estimated 0.01. And this is the variance of the idiosyncratic noise in tax signal, which I estimated very high. So what does the numbers tell me? When the variance of noise is very low here, this signal is very precise. So you almost perfectly observe the demand that is going to be directed to your island, to your case. But when the variance of the tax signal is very large, then this signal is not precise. Okay, it's very noisy. So you underestimate your tax obligations excessively relative to the government. So basically you expect government demand here, but tax obligations here. So the difference is positive. That's why you expect higher disposable income. So basically, this imperfect information structure breaks the Ricardian equilibrium. That's the whole story here. You don't perfectly observe. So you make expectational errors, but you make expectational errors more in your tax obligations. So you underestimate it, but relative to your government demand, and your disposable income is higher. That's the whole story here. So how the model works.
We forget to pay taxes.
You expect, but later you are learning. Later you learn your obligations.
Yeah. So the policy implication is that basically, if that tax, that extra consumption needs to be taxed, it should be taxed directly through VAT, because on income, basically the agents are not able to properly match.
Yes. Exactly. Yes. Because it's a lump sum tax, so yeah, exactly, DAT tax.
But then we come back to my first question. If the government announces higher consumption and higher DAT,
this is the key issue here. So they, if they only announce consumption without touching the house company in my hands, it can work here. Like consider the fiscal stimulus. People were talking, like when they implement stimulus, they were talking about how much job they will recover, how much GDP will grow. They were silent about how it's
going. How it's financed. Okay.
So that's why that demand signal might be very precise. Mm-hmm. So people might agree on that, but not the tax signal.
Strategic uncertainty.
Yeah, exactly. 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 Then, okay, I can skip here. So basically in this paper I show that confidence is important in transmission of fiscal spending shock. So we know that managing expectations are very important in the conduct of monetary policy. Here I show this is also the case for in the conduct of fiscal policy, managing expectations. And in the future, I would like to enrich my VAR with imperfect information of other variables. Also, I will look at richer fiscal policy or even monetary policy. And maybe I will do later Bayesian estimations rather than impulse response matching estimation. I think I'm done with the time.
Very good.
Okay. Yeah. So thank you for all listening me.
So for those of you who are interested in details, the slides will be online on our website, so you can get up there today, and probably we'll link also to the paper. Any questions, comments to the speaker?
We have a couple questions. So you estimate the model by matching impulse responses.
Yes.
And then you compare these impulse responses. So
yes,
I would expect that by procedure, it will be very close. I mean, like you choose parameters that try to minimize the errors between impulse responses, right?
Exactly.
So then, in terms of estimated parameters, do you find some differences? I mean, some big
relative to the literature?
Exactly.
Yeah. One is this, persistence of monetary policy rule. In my case, it is low, but in the literature, this is like 0.7, 0.8. So here it is low. So monetary policy is not that persistent in my case, which I needed to have the results. And other than that, all these parameters are new here. All these parameters are new. And so only this, because like the main parameters here, I calibrate them. Like the discount factor or like Kalo parameters, they're all calibrated.
And my last question, why do you use this island approach? What do you, how it helps you? And like, why don't you make life easier and go forward?
Because I want Ricardian households to expect increase in their income. Because
okay.
That's what empirical analysis tells me.
Yeah. But so each island has Ricardians and non-Ricardians, or you have islands?
No, I have everyone Ricardian.
Everyone
Ricardian.
So you don't have non-Ricardian?
No.
Okay.
I don't have.
But again, why?
So in RBC, like in standard
yes.
Ricard, because the following government spending shock, it's standard utility functions. Ricardians will expect decrease in their income.
Right, but if you put
so they are less confident.
Right, but if you put, for example, you make a tweak, you put non-Ricardians to the model, you will probably have the same response of consumption, a positive response.
Yes, yeah, okay, I can manage to match the consumption, but then I cannot manage to match the confidence.
Right.
Because then their confidence should be
negative. So now the question is whether it's an effect of confidence or probably this is you capture an effect of non-Ricardians in the equation.
It's confidence.
Okay, well, let's be confident. Thank you.
I have some questions. Thank you for your speech here. It was very great. And the first question is about estimation of confidence. How did you estimate the confidence of consumers and business? The second one is about what do you think, is it possible to apply your model to Ukrainian economy with its specificity. I mean, lack of confidence and the reduction of spending about governance.
First, this is the, I use Michigan University Consumer Confidence Expectations Index. So this is how they construct this index. So every month they call the households and ask these three questions. And then they average those responses and make an index out of this, out of their answers. Here, I need some sort of survey data to be able to calibrate my model to Ukrainian economy. I don't know if you have survey data about. It doesn't have to be fiscal policy. It can, this, because this model can be also studied for monetary policy. Like if agents, let's say, if there is imperfect information among agents, and they say if central bank has superior information, and when government, when central bank announces policy changes, it can affect also expectations of the agents because they may update. But to control for this, I need a survey data. I don't know if you have a survey of households in Ukraine or not.
Probably not in exactly the same structure as there, but there, some, there are surveys on inflation, expectation, all kinds of things.
How might they policy also?
Because
then you can.
Consumption, prices, expectations. We have a pretty good survey, a business survey. They have different types of expectations there, but not monetary.
I mean, this model can be also looked from firm side also. Like you can change the story from firm side. So as you sell to other firms, you can expect, so as long as there are expectation errors, that you can make, this is possible using this model. But I need some survey data to be able to control for these expectations.
Thank you very much. Any more questions? No? Well, thank you.
Thank you.